Hello everyone, my today's lecture is about bacterial meningitis in children, and the content of my presentation include introduction, risk factor, etiology, pathogenesis, clinical manifestation, diagnosis, treatment, and prognosis, and also prevention of meningitis in children. When we came to introduction, meningitis is defined as inflammation of the leptomeninges or inflammation of the two inner line of the meninges, including the pia mater and the arachnoid mater. As you see on the image, there are three layers of meninges that cover the brain and the spinal cord: pia mater, arachnoid mater, and the dura mater. The two inner layers are called pia mater and the arachnoid mater. So when we say meningitis, it is an inflammation of the leptomeninges or the two inner line of the meninges. And bacterial meningitis is an acute and a diffuse bacterial infection of the CNS with primary involvement of the leptomeninges. Infection of the CNS has been classified according to the affected tissue, and meningitis describes primary involvement of the meninges, whereas encephalitis indicates brain parenchymal involvement. However, these anatomic boundaries might be indistinct during infection, and patients might have evidence of both meningeal and parenchymal involvement. Terms such as meningoencephalitis may better describe diffuse infection of CNS by pathogenesis such as virus. Brain abscess is the most common example of focal infection of the CNS. So, infection of the CNS is classified as a diffuse or focal. Meningitis, encephalitis, or meningoencephalitis are classified as a diffuse type, and the focal infection of the CNS is the best example is brain abscess. When a child has a fever and altered mental status, always consider meningitis until alternate diagnosis rules it out. So a child with fever and altered mental status should be thought of as having meningitis till we rule out it. When we came to the risk factors for meningitis, a major risk factors for bacterial meningitis is a lack of pre-existing immunity to specific pathogens and the serotypes. This is reflected by the high incidence of meningitis in young infants. And additional risk factors include recent colonization with a pathogenic bacteria, close contact such as household host contact, daycare centers, and the like with individuals having invasive disease caused by Neisseria meningitis or Haemophilus influenza type B, and crowding, poverty, and also male gender, and also black race is also thought to be as a risk factors for meningitis. The mode of transmission of this pathogen is through contact with respiratory tract secretions or droplets, and the risk of meningitis is increased among infants and young children with occult bacteremia. So, overall, the risk factors for meningitis: young age due to lack of immunity, male gender, poverty, overcrowding, recent colonization with pathogenic bacteria, bacteremia, close contact with a person affected by Neisseria meningitis or Haemophilus influenza meningitis. The other risk factors for meningitis: anatomic defects such as lumbosacral dermal sinus, ruptured meningomyelocele, ventriculoperitoneal shunt, otitis media, cochlear transplant, midline cranial or facial defects, and the basal skull fracture. And also, in addition, complement deficiency, TCL lymphocyte defect or chemotherapy, and also anatomic or functional asplenia is also associated with high risk of having meningitis than when we compare to other similar age groups of children who do not have those problems. When we see the etiologic agent of meningitis in children, most of the time viral infections are more common than that of bacterial CNS infection. But bacterial CNS infection is more common than that of fungal and the parasitic. So viral infections are greater than that of bacterial, and bacterial is more common than fungal and the parasitic. And factors affecting etiologic agent depends on one, age of the host; second, immune status of the host; and vaccination status of the child. Predisposing factors and anatomic factors that we have described above all plays their own role in affecting the etiologic agent of bacteria that causes CNS infection. The etiologic agents from when we see based on the age, the etiologic agent from birth to 2 months includes from gram positive group B streptococcus or streptococcus agalactia, and group D streptococcus are more common. From gram negative, E. coli, Klebsiella, and Listeria monocytogenes are common in those less than 2 months of age. When we see those between 2 months and above, from gram positive, strep pneumonia is more common, whereas from gram negative, Haemophilus influenza and Neisseria meningitis are more common. Other etiologies that cause meningitis in above 2 months old includes from gram positive staph aureus, coagulus negative staph, and from gram negative pseudomonas and salmonella can cause meningitis in those above 2 months of age. When we see the specific bacteria that cause CNS infection in those above 2 months of age, the first one is Streptococcus pneumonia, and invasive pneumococcal infections are at its peak age in those between 6 months to 2 years of age. And risk factors for having invasive pneumococcal infection include anatomic or functional asplenia, retroviral infection, otitis media, sinusitis, pneumonia, CSF otoria or rhinorrhea, and cochlear implants. They are high risk factor for predisposing a child to have pneumococcal meningitis. In addition to this, unvaccinated child is also another risk factor for having invasive pneumococcal infection. Prevention include pneumococcal vaccine. So there are different pneumococcal vaccines that is given at different countries. Certain countries give 13 valent pneumococcal conjugate vaccine, whereas other countries give 10 valent pneumococcal conjugate vaccine. So the most important preventive mechanism of invasive pneumococcal infection is the other etiology of meningitis in bacterial meningitis in above 2 months old include Neisseria meningitis. There are six serogroups of meningococcus A, B, C, X, Y, and the W135. They are responsible for invasive disease in humans. Meningococcal meningitis may be sporadic or it may occur in major epidemics, particularly in African meningitis belt, where a serogroup A accounts for 80 to 85% of outbreaks. Meningococcal cases are more common in the winter and the spring, and likely due to association with a viral infection, including influenza. Nasopharyngeal carriage of Neisseria meningitis occur in 1 to 50% of adults, and most infections of children are acquired from a contact in a daycare facility, a colonized adult family member, or in all patients, in ill patients with a meningococcal disease. Colonization may last weeks to months, and recent colonization places non-immune younger children at a greatest risk for meningitis. The incidence of disease occurring in association with index case in the family is 1%. That is a rate that is 1,000-fold the risk in the general population. The risk of secondary cases occurring in contact at the daycare center is approximately 1 in 1,000. And children younger than 5 years of age have the highest rates of meningococcal infection. The other bacterial etiologies of meningitis in above 2 months old is Haemophilus influenza type B. Before universal Haemophilus influenza type B vaccination, approximately 70% of cases of bacterial meningitis occurring in the first 5 years of life were caused by this pathogen. Invasive infection occurred primarily in infants 2 months to 2 years of age, and the peak incidence was at 6 to 9 months of age, and 50% of cases occurred in the first year of life. The risk to children was markedly increased among family or daycare center contacts of patients with Haemophilus influenza type B disease. And the risks of the risk factor for having Haemophilus influenza meningitis is contact with Haemophilus influenza type B incompletely vaccinated or not vaccinated, and also retroviral infection, as we have mentioned. When we see the pathogenesis, bacterial meningitis outside the neonatal period is typically due to bacterial colonization of the nasopharynx with subsequent invasion into the bloodstream, causing bacteremia. The bacterial organisms then breach the blood-brain barrier and enter the CNS to cause infection and inflammation. These steps involve complex interaction between the host and the pathogen, and many of the mechanisms still require further study. Meningitic pathogens frequently colonize the nasopharynx of the children, but rapid invasion after recent colonization might also occur. The microbiome of the nasopharynx is a complex community of bacteria that may enhance or inhibit colonization of other bacteria. For example, strep pneumonia can synthesize hydrogen peroxide, which can inhibit growth of Haemophilus influenza type B. Conversely, Haemophilus influenza type B can invoke a specific immune response that targets clearance of streptococcal pneumonia. Other bacteria may alter the microbiome of the nasopharynx, and the studies after the implement of pneumococcal vaccine identified alteration in the composition of nasopharyngeal bacterial population. After attachment to epithelial cells, bacteria bridge the mucosa and enter the bloodstream. Then, various models of invasion have been developed for different bacteria. Overall, nasopharyngeal colonization with pathogenic organisms such as Haemophilus influenza, Neisseria meningitis, and streptococcal pneumonia is the first thing to happen. And then, if there is recent upper respiratory tract infection, this enhances pathogenicity of the colonizing bacteria and causes bacteremia. Then, meningitis will develop. Other thing is local invasion from a contagious focal infection, such as otitis media, sinusitis, and the like. Neisseria meningitis and Haemophilus influenza type B attach to the mucosal epithelial cell receptors by pili and they breach the mucosa and enter the circulation. And Neisseria meningitis may be transported across the mucosal surface within a phagocytic vacuole after ingestion by the epithelial cells. Bacterial survival in the bloodstream is enhanced by a large bacterial capsule that interferes with opsonic phagocytosis. In a young non-immune hostess, the defect may be due to an absence of preformed IgM or IgAnti capsular antibodies, whereas in immunodeficient patients, various deficiency of components of the complement or properly system might interfere with effective opsonic phagocytosis. And splenic dysfunction may also reduce opsonic phagocytosis by a reticuloendothelial system. Overall, the pathogens include epithelial attachment of pathogenic bacteria by pili and breach epithelial mucosa, then enter the bloodstream and a defective immune response causes bacteremia. Bacteria reach the choroid plexus and the CSF and circulate in the CSF and reach the meninges and extracerebral area. This causes bacterial multiplication in the chemotaxis and also meningeal inflammation, meningitis happen. When we see the pathology of meningitis, direct damage to the CNS by the inflammatory process or immune-mediated damage induced by bacterial components are the two mechanisms that cause a pathology. When we see the direct damage to CNS by inflammatory process, it includes neutrophilic infiltration, increased vascular permeability, alteration of the blood-brain barrier, and vascular thrombosis. Whereas the immune-mediated damage induced by different damage might be caused by meningitis, but it varies from person to person. But the most common damage that is caused by meningitis include extensive exudates in the CSF circulation pathways causing communicating hydrocephalus, subdural infusion or empyema, ventriculitis, necrotizing arthritis causing subarachnoid hemorrhage, cranial nerve palsy, cerebral infarction, increased intracranial pressure and cerebral herniation. These all things can be caused by meningitis. When we see the mechanisms of cerebral injury that causes those all damage, damage to the cerebral cortex might be due to the focal or diffuse effects of vascular occlusion, which can be from infarction, from necrosis or from lactic acidosis, hypoxia, bacterial invasion of the brain itself or cerebrites, toxic encephalopathy or bacterial toxins, toxins that is released from bacteria, elevated ICP, ventriculitis, transudation and that causes subdural effusion. They all contribute to the mechanisms of cerebral injury that cause all the clinical symptoms that we have described above. The effects of cerebral injury include impaired consciousness or coma, seizure, cranial nerve deficits, motor and sensory deficits, and later long-term effects such as psychomotor retardation might happen. When we see the mechanisms of increased ICP, increased ICP is the result of either a cell death that is called cytotoxic cerebral edema, and cytokine-induced increased capillary vascular permeability or vasogenic cerebral edema, and increased hydrostatic pressure or interstitial cerebral edema after obstructive reabsorption of CSF in the arachnoid villus or obstruction of the flow of fluid from the ventricles can happen. So the mechanisms of increased ICP includes cytotoxic cerebral edema, vasogenic cerebral edema, and interstitial cerebral edema. And also in addition to those three things, SIDH, syndrome of inappropriate antidiuretic hormone, causes interstitial edema. This causes retention of water, which contributes for having interstitial edema. When we see the clinical manifestation of bacterial meningitis, the onset of acute meningitis has two predominant patterns. Most often, meningitis is preceded by several days of fever accompanied by upper respiratory tract or gastrointestinal symptoms followed by non-specific signs of CNS infection such as increasing lethargy and irritability. Fortunately, the more dramatic presentation is less common in the presentation with sudden and progressive shock, purpura, DIC, reduced level of consciousness, often resulting in progression to coma or death within 24 hours. So, either it is the most common presentation is the several days of fever followed by upper respiratory tract or GI symptoms, then signs symptoms of CNS infection appear 1 or 2 days later, whereas the sudden and the dramatic presentation is less common. The signs and the symptoms of meningitis are related to the non-specific findings associated with systemic infection and the manifestation of meningeal irritation. Non-specific findings include fever, anorexia, and poor feeding, and also headache, upper respiratory symptoms, myalgia, arthralgia, tachycardia, hypotension, and various cutaneous signs, such as petechiae, purpura, or erythematous macular rash. The rash of meningococcemia is typified by initial petechiae rash that evolves into ecchymotic and purpuric lesion. And meningeal irritation is manifested by nuchal rigidity, back pain, Kernighi sign, and the Brudinski sign. In children, particularly in those younger than 18 months, the Kernighi and the Brudinski signs are not consistently present. And even in adults, fever, headache, and nuchal rigidity are present in only 30 to 40% of cases of bacterial meningitis. So as I have said, Kernighi and the Brudinski signs are inconsistently found in younger children less than 18 months, and the meningeal irritation signs are present in 60 to 80% of children with a bacterial meningitis, and in approximately 25% of children with a normal CSF finding. So the triad of fever, neck stiffness, mental status changes is present in only 30 to 40% of adults with bacterial meningitis, and it's even lower for children. When we see the diagnosis of meningitis, lumbar puncture in order to obtain CSF for gram stain in the culture is the most important step in the diagnosis of meningitis. In addition, testing the CSF for neutrophilic pilocytosis, elevated protein, and the reduced glucose concentration can provide results within a few hours, and it could be suggestive of a diagnosis of bacterial meningitis. Contraindication to do immediate lumbar puncture include evidence of increased ICP other than a bulging fontanel, such as third or sixth cranial nerve palsy with a depressed level of consciousness, or the Cushing reflex, as we have said above, hypertension and the bradycardia associated with respiratory abnormality. So increased ICP with third or sixth cranial nerve palsy or depressed level of consciousness or Cushing reflex is a contraindication to doing lumbar puncture immediately. The other contraindication is severe cardiopulmonary compromise requiring prompt resuscitation measures for shock, or in a patient in whom positioning for lumbar puncture would further compromise cardiopulmonary functions are another contraindication. And infection of the skin overlying the site of the lumbar puncture is also the third contraindication. Thrombocytopenia is a relative contraindication for LAP, and if an LAP is delayed, empirical antibiotic therapy should be initiated. If we delay LAP, we should have to start empirical antibiotic, and then we should have to send head CT scan prior to LAP to evaluate for evidence of increased ICP. As an LAP in the setting of elevated ICP could cause brain herniation. However, head CT scan might delay diagnosis of meningitis and initiation of antimicrobials, and it does not always rule out increased ICP. Therefore, routine head CT scan prior to LAP are not recommended unless the patient has a clinical signs, or unless the patient has risk of elevated ICP, including papilledema, focal neurologic findings, coma, history of hydrocephalus, history of previous neurosurgical procedures, including CSF-sufficient placement. However, if the decision is made to obtain a CT scan prior to LAP, antimicrobial therapy should not be delayed, and LAP might be performed after increased ICP has been appropriately treated. After doing lumbar puncture, we should have to analyze the CSF, but the CSF WBC count varies with age. Normal CSF WBC finding in neonates might be up to 30 leukocytes, but this majority of the cells should be lymphocytes. And in older children, up to 5 cells are normal, but the majority should be still lymphocytes. Turbid CSF is present when the CSF leukocyte count is greater than 400 per millimeter cube. And in most bacterial meningitis, CSF leukocyte count is greater than 1000 with neutrophil predominance of more than 75%. And also, there is increment in protein and a decrement in a glucose level. Pilocytosis may be absent in a patient with severe overwhelming sepsis and meningitis. So, absence of pilocytosis in the CSF is a poor prognostic factor. Gram stain is positive in 70 to 90% of patients with untreated bacterial meningitis. A diagnostic conundrum in the evaluation of children with a suspected bacterial meningitis is the analysis of CSF obtained from children with already receiving antibiotic therapy. If a child is using antibiotic when we do lumbar puncture, CSF obtained from children with bacterial meningitis can be negative on gram stain in the culture, even as early as 4 hours after administration of antibiotic. Pilocytosis with a predominance of neutrophils, elevated protein level, and the reduced concentration of CSF glucose will usually persist for several days, and they are used to make a presumptive diagnosis of bacterial meningitis in a children who came to us after taking antibiotics or in a partially treated bacterial meningitis. We use CSF WBC count with a predominance of neutrophils and elevated protein level and a reduced concentration of CSF glucose. But we don't use gram stain and the culture because they disappear immediately. Whereas the other thing is analyzing a traumatic LP. A traumatic LP complicates the interpretation of CSF test, and a CSF leukocyte and the protein concentration are significantly affected by a traumatic LP. But we should have to use the gram stain, culture, and the glucose level. So if it's a traumatic LP, we depend on gram stain, culture, and the glucose level. But if it is a partially treated meningitis, we use WBC count, protein level, and the glucose level. But we don't use gram stain and the culture. The other important thing is blood culture. Blood culture should be performed in all patients with a suspected meningitis, and the blood cultures reveal the responsible bacteria in up to 80-90% of cases of meningitis. Elevation of CRP, ESR, and the procalcitonin can be seen in both bacteria and the viral meningitis, and should be not used to routinely determine which patient should receive antibiotics. When we see the treatment about bacterial meningitis, essential to improving clinical outcomes in a patient with bacterial meningitis is prompt recognition, diagnostic testing, and the initiation of appropriate antimicrobial therapy early as fast as possible. Empirical antibiotic therapy include the first line therapy is vancomycin with third generation cephalosporin, such as ceftriaxone or cefotaxime. If the patient is allergic to penicillin or cephalosporin, we can use meropenem. And if we suspect Listeria monocytogenes, for example, in more younger age group and in those who have T lymphocyte deficiency, we can add ampicillin to ceftriaxone and vancomycin. And supportive therapy is very important. Maintenance fluid, two-third maintenance fluid, because of the risk of syndrome of inappropriate antidiuretic hormone, we should have to use two-third maintenance fluid of the daily requirement. And also, we should have to manage complications like increased ICP and duration of therapies is based on the etiology. Neisseria meningitis is treated for 5 to 7 days. Haemophilus influenza type is treated for 7 to 10 days. And partially treated meningitis treated with ceftriaxone or cefotaxime for 7 to 10 days. Whereas gram-negative bacillary meningitis for 3 weeks or for at least 2 weeks after CSF sterilization. Repeated examination of CSF is not indicated for all patients. Currently, the indication to repeat lumbar fracture for CSF analysis is indicated for all certain units. In patients with meningitis from a gram-negative bacillus and patients with infection caused by beta-lactam resistance. The other important thing that we should have to discuss about corticosteroid in the treatment of bacterial meningitis in children. Rapid killing of bacteria in CSF effectively sterilizes the meningeal infection, but it causes the release of toxic cell products after cell lyases, such as endotoxin. This precipitates the cytokine-mediated inflammatory response. So the resultant edema formation and the neutrophilic infiltration may produce additional neurologic injury with a worsening of CNS signs and the symptoms. Therefore, agents that limit production of inflammatory mediators could be beneficial in a bacterial meningitis. Using steroids in a meningitis treatment, steroid reduced hearing loss in a children with a meningitis due to Haemophilus influenza type B, but not due to other pathogens. The use of steroids in children did not reduce mortality rates. However, steroids did improve survival rates in adults with pneumococcal meningitis. Most studies support the use of dexamethasone, 0.15 mg per kg per dose, every 6 hours for 2 days, in a treatment of Haemophilus influenza type meningitis in a children older than 6 months. But still, corticosteroids appear to have a maximum benefit if given 1 to 2 hours before antibiotics administration, and even it is also beneficial if given concurrently with antibiotics. Still, there is some studies that says in addition to Haemophilus influenza type B, corticosteroids are also important for meningitis caused by strep pneumonia. So we should have to give dexamethasone 0.15 mg per kg per dose every 6 for 2 days. The other issues about partially treated meningitis. Many children receive antibiotics before a definitive diagnosis is made. As a rule, a few doses of oral antimicrobial agents or even a single injection of antibiotic do not alter CSF findings, including bacterial culture, especially in a patient with Haemophilus influenza type B disease, but they influence Neisseria meningitis and streptococcal pneumonia. CSF culture might become sterile rapidly if the pathogen was pneumococcus and meningococcus, although cellular changes and an increase in protein and low glucose level persist. So as we have said, if we are treating a partially treated meningitis, if we are taking a sample of CSF after the patient started antibiotics, we should have to depend on the CSF cell count, CSF protein, and the CSF glucose. We don't depend on gram stain and the culture. If it is positive, that's good. If it's negative, we don't say there is no meningitis. So, because CSF gram stain and the cultures are rapidly eliminated after antibiotic is started. To confirm recent infection, we can also use a latex agglutination test. If focal signs are present or the child does not respond to treatment, a parameningeal focus may present and the CT or MRI scan should be performed. When we see the complications after bacterial meningitis, we classify complications into acute complications and long-term complications. The acute complications include seizure, increased ICP, cerebral edema, ischemia and thrombosis, cranial nerve palsy, cerebral herniation, subdural infusion, disseminated illness such as septic arthritis, pericarditis, and DIC, and also SIDH. Whereas the long-term or chronic complications are merely neurologic sequelae. They include sensory neural hearing loss, mental retardation, recurrent seizure, delay in acquisition of language, visual impairment, and behavioral problems. From this, sensory neural hearing loss is the most common chronic complication. Poor prognostic factors, age less than 6 months, high concentration of bacteria and the bacterial products in the CSF, seizure lasting more than 4 days into therapy, coma or focal neurologic signs at presentation, and pneumococcal meningitis etiologies, a poor prognostic sign. In addition to this, high concentration of bacteria or bacterial product in the CSF is poor prognostic. In addition, lack of CSF pilocytosis is also another poor prognostic sign. When we see the prevention, vaccination is very important. Vaccination and antibiotic prophylaxis of suspected at-risk contacts represent two opportunities to reduce the transmission and development of secondary cases of bacterial meningitis. Haemophilus influenza type B isolates can persist in nasopharyngeal secretions even after a successful treatment of meningitis. For this reason, the patient must be given rifampin 20 mg per kg once daily for 4 days. If high-risk children are at home or as a child care center, unless the medication was ceftriaxone. Neisseria meningitis chemoprophylaxis is recommended for all close contacts of patients with meningococcal meningitis, regardless of age or immunization status, and close contacts should be treated with rifampin 10 mg per kg per dose every 12 hours for 2 days, as soon as possible after identification of a case of suspected meningococcal meningitis or sepsis. So, vaccination and antibiotic prophylaxis of a susceptible at-risk contact represents the two most opportunities to reduce transmission and development of secondary cases of bacterial meningitis. Thank you. This is what I have about bacterial meningitis in children. Don't forget to subscribe the channel.